College for post-secondary planning night. We've had this activity specifically for juniors at Fairmont High School for now north of 30 years. So as long as parents keep showing up in the guidance office, we'll hopefully you'll find some very real value and try to share some practical examples and experiences that families have had in general here. So we're glad you're here tonight. This is also another new one. We've had years where school has been canceled during the day, so that kind of makes it easy for us in the office to like all evening activities are canceled. This is obviously the first time that school has been called on the night before or the night during the junior parent night. So I genuinely wasn't sure how many folks would show up this evening knowing there's no school tomorrow. So I appreciate that very much. Those of you that are sending your first one or your oldest one off to school, if you look around the room, we have some veteran parents that have kids in college or at post-secondary. Parents are outstanding resources about what's to come. In probably a little bit of less than an hour tonight, I'm going to really take you through about really the next 15 months leading up to graduation. And I did, when I went through the classrooms earlier this week, I said to the kids, I'm not going to look for a response, but I bet if I would ask you, you know, are you ready to get out of the house and be done and go on to the next stage? And most days, students would tell you yes. And even though there's snow on the ground, I often think of graduation time and going to open houses for seniors in the spring of the year. I still very much consider it a privilege and really an honor when families think enough of you as their student has gone through the system to come to their open house. And how I'll tie that in real quickly is there's been themes as I've gone to open houses over the years with our seniors, and I think they're very appropriate or apropos for us as the class of 2018, heading to the home stretch of your senior year. And as I've talked to parents in different manners, both moms and dads over the years, there's more than this, but there's kind of one theme. Once graduation rolls through and the open house season begins, one is that time has gone very fast as a parent. And looking back from maybe diapers to now heading into your senior year. Number two, there are probably times as parents that you're ready to send your son or daughter out of the house tonight as if possible. They can't get out of the house soon enough. And there are probably days or weeks or maybe longer where you feel like, man, this is outstanding. You wish you could keep your son or daughter, you know, in the house, maybe not forever, but for an extended period of time. So why I even share that with you right now is I just would encourage each and every one of you to really appreciate the highs and the lows during the next 15 months, because obviously there's a very big life transitioning that's going to take place both for you as parents and for students. The timeline that we're going to go through here very quickly or fairly quickly tonight, it works. It's changed a little bit over the years. The only way the timeline does not work for you or for us is if you don't engage with it. So to meet in a, you know, at the end of February of your junior year, hopefully I'll give you some things to think about, hopefully give you some common questions that come up from students and parents over the years. And the first place where I'm going to maybe take you, if you want to use it as a resource, one of the first handouts is a timetable. And really the first piece of this, I know this is kind of hard to see on the overhead. Really, the first piece of it starts tonight. You made it to junior parent night on February 23rd. You made it. Welcome. Welcome. There's some materials on the table. No problem. Really, the next big piece that's going to take place this spring, and we'll hit that here in a few minutes, is ACT testing. And whether you're thinking about your son or daughter going on to a two-year vocational school, or you know they're going to go the four-year route. And the last few years, we've done something that's fairly rare for most high schools in the state. So as we kind of go through this evening, the timeline that you kind of see in front of you is the direction that we're going to take you. The other place that that I would say is if you have some questions, want to try to keep this relatively informal. I know there are some veteran parents that their students are in college right now. If you have some insight that maybe will help our class of 2018 parents that are going through this for the first time, please feel free to share. So we want to try to make this as comfortable as setting as possible. The first place where I'm going to take you here, and hopefully if you grabbed a yellow two-year choosing a college booklet, maybe your son or daughter knows right now exactly what it is they're going to do when they graduate. Maybe they have that all planned out. Maybe your son or daughter right now may not have a real big clue in terms of what life might entail once you graduate from high school. I want to reassure you, both students and parents, that if you're on either one of those continuums, it's okay. I'll typically tell students, the good news about meeting right now and having this conversation in February is you don't have to make any life-changing decisions tonight. We have the next 15 months, by the time the graduation rolls around, to get a direction or a program of study. So I'll just use this as a reference. Inside the yellow booklet, if your son or daughter's looking to maybe go to a two-year school after graduation from FHS, I'll give you some quick examples. Minnesota West and Jackson, Riverland and Austin and Albert Lea, to our South Iowa Lakes Community College, and to our north, the South Central College of Mankato. They're now a two-year or four-year school. By the way, we do have former Fairmont graduates at each one of those institutions here very recently. How this may be helpful for you is if you maybe take a look at, this will be a little difficult to see on the screen, maybe I can get it just a little bit larger, but we'll just use a two-year program as an example. And just for fun, let's just say that Mr. Geerdes wants to be a baking and pastry chef. Now, feel free to write on this, use it as a handout, those kind of things. Maybe that's an interest for you right now. I used to like to use kind of a bad joke, but maybe you're interested in being a beautician. Maybe you're interested in being a mortician right now. Both ends are completely okay. Now, part of the process in kind of working through this is you can see the programs of study going down in the left-hand column, and then you just follow to the right to find a dot across the page, and believe it or not, go to the Art Institute International and become a bakery and pastry chef. You also can go to Hennepin Tech College and University to do the same. Now, many of you in here, I know, probably are looking the four-year college route. If that would be you, if you flip back, you can start on page 18. And again, the nice thing is you don't have to make any decisions today. But one of the resources and things, maybe the first seed that I'll plant for you as a group that I shared with the kids earlier this week, is maybe the first things to think about, talk about in your homes, is what exactly do you potentially want to study? Are you going a two-year, four-year route? And then really, once you maybe have a little bit of an idea of a program of study, which institutions in the state of Minnesota are available for you to go to those programs. So over the years, this has been a pretty good handout, a very good handout, and feedback from parents has really told us that, you know, it's a really helpful tool for us to start the process. Now the next piece here, and just for reference, is the blue handout. And in the blue handout are all the two-year and four-year schools in the state of Minnesota. And I have a few bad jokes, but we're reaching to the part of the program where I'm going to ask you to please not shoot the messenger, and I'm going to tell you why in just a few moments, okay? Generally speaking, most of our Fairmont High School graduates, a few will stay in town and go to Presentation College. But most of our students will probably go somewhere between 2 and 4 or 5 hours away from Fairmont. Now, maybe one of the beauties of our location along Interstate 90, most of our kids go probably once they graduate to 5 or 6 states. They stay in Minnesota, obviously, but we send kids to South Dakota, North Dakota, Wisconsin, Nebraska, and Iowa. So as you're starting to look at the college process or the post-secondary process, one of the next things to maybe start to consider as a family and as a student is how far or how close do you want to get to or from Fairmont? Now, most of our students will go far enough where maybe they can kind of blaze their own path, for lack of a better word. But yet, if they want to get home for Thanksgiving break, for Christmas break, then you can get back within a day's drive, okay? Another piece to maybe consider that the resource here may be helpful for you is, what are you looking for in terms of a community to spend the next 2 or 4 years? And I'll just pick Gustavus here as an example because it's relatively close to Fairmont. Obviously, by college standards, Gustavus is a very small town. We also send quite a few students, by the way, to the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, which obviously is very metropolitan. Just did a little research today in preparation for tonight. I just pulled up the undergraduate enrollment at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities right now, and their website popped up, obviously, and they have around 30,500 students. So as you start to think about transitioning from high school to post-secondary, you maybe want to, how far, how close do you want to get to Fairmont? Are you looking for maybe a smaller school or a little bit larger than your experience here at Fairmont High School, where you know most people in your dorm, you walk into the classroom and students know you by name, the professors know you by name, or maybe you're ready to go out and really spread your wings and start anew and go someplace that's much larger where folks don't know you. And maybe the analogy of being a big fish in a small town in Fairmont, that maybe you're ready to go out and have that experience at a larger institution. Oh, by the way, both of those things are very much okay. There's absolutely nothing wrong with those directions. What I've told our students, and we'll probably continue to say here as we move forward, you might be thinking one direction right now, your best friend might be thinking 180 degrees the other way, and both of those things are perfectly normal and perfectly natural. Again, one of the beauties of tonight is that you don't have to decide right now what it's going to look like. So just very quickly, some other things to think about in terms of enrollment size. When you look at the student-to-faculty ratio, obviously that's exactly what it is. At Gustavus, for every 12 students, they have at least one professor. The average class size at Gustavus is around 35 students, really not that much larger than what your students are experiencing right now at Fairmont High School. We'll get to a little bit tonight, touch a little bit about the online applications. We want to make sure we get our seniors applied in the fall of their senior year, and we'll hit that in a few moments. And this is the part, tongue-in-cheek, where those of you that are sending your students to college for the first time, please don't shoot me, okay? Don't shoot the messenger. But under, I know it's bad, stuff might snow outside, I got it. But at Gustavus right now, their tuition and fees are around $41,000. So that's the cost of taking coursework, the cost of any fees, technology, those kind of things. Room and board, obviously, are living in the dorm rooms for at least a year. And kind of meal plans, anything that goes in with the dorm rooms. And then books of supplies are around $2,000. Now, before maybe you experience or have just experienced sticker shock, I would say, very generally speaking, don't throw a private school out just because of the cost of tuition. Not in all cases and with all families, but in many, many cases for our students that go on to a public school like Gustavus, the tuition and fees, or the out-of-pocket expenses, are very competitive than their public school brethren. Now the question is, maybe how can that be, Mr. Geerdes? Most private schools and private colleges have huge endowment funds, if not in the hundreds of thousands, in the millions of dollars. And that's the way, in many occasions for families, when you get your financial aid package and you see in black and white how much is it going to cost to send your son or daughter to school, that the private institutions, in many cases, can be very competitive. So obviously one of the big pieces that families and students that go into their college choice or their post-secondary choice is, what is it going to cost you out of pocket? So just to kind of ease into that whole financial aid and tuition piece right now as juniors, feedback from mom and dads over the years has been, you know, I'd much rather know what's coming at us potentially here in about 15 months. So again, absolutely feel free to look through any and all of the two-year schools there. If you're looking to go out of state, this resource is not for you. We get this from the Department of Education here in Minnesota, so it's all just Minnesota two-year and four-year schools. Okay? Any questions at all right now? All right, I'm going to keep you moving here. If you would turn your timetable over, on the back of your timetable, here in a few weeks or in a few short months, really the first piece that our students are going to do as juniors is take the ACT exam. And this may be a little bit hard to read in the back. Mrs. Schweber and I use the term guidelines here. In a couple of weeks, we'll actually start registration for the next school year. We give actually all of our current sophomores and juniors their current transcripts with their grades, their academic work to date, and it all kind of starts to tie together about what are some of the requirements at the post-secondary schools that are out there. Now, we use the term guidelines, and if you'd ask me off the record from year to year, how easy or how difficult is it for our Fairmont High School students to get into a college or university or even a two-year school, I would tell you off the record, probably depends on how many applications a college or university is getting. Meaning, the more applications that come into the admissions office during the fall of the student's senior year before graduation, the more selective colleges can be with accepting students and giving them a thumbs up. Yes, you can come to our school. Yes, we can come to our school. Yes, we'd like you to come to our school. On a rare occasion, no, we won't. So just to give you some guidelines here about where our kids are landing in the Midwest, Minnesota State Universities, examples obviously would be MSU Mankato, St. Cloud State, Bemidji State, MSU Moorhead, as examples. Typically, if our students score a 21 on the ACT or higher, they're in the top 50% or the top half of your class academically and have a 3.0 grade point average, B as in boy, or higher. I won't say with 100%, but I feel more than very confident that our Fairmont High School students graduating out of here with those credentials will get in on the first time. SDSU, just for clarification, is South Dakota State in Brookings, South Dakota. We have maybe between 10 and 20 students there right now. USD is the University of South Dakota in Vermilion. Typically for the South Dakota schools, if you have an 18 minimum, ACT or higher, or in the top 60%, 2.6 GPA. Now, University of Minnesota Twin Cities, you'll see a squiggly line there. It varies from year to year. The U, typically on the low end with our seniors that are getting in there, have a 24 ACT on the low end. Most of our kids that are getting in automatically or right away after application probably have an ACT score of 26 or higher. But I can tell you with much confidence, our students that are around a 24 to 26 or higher with their ACT score and are in the top 25% of their class through their junior year and are graduating in that range are getting into the U. Now, the question typically becomes, as Scott, you just told me, where there's about 30,500 undergraduate students. That's a big school. How can they have higher admission standards than, like, an MSU Mankato? I'll use very quickly the term pop. There are a ton within the thousands of students, not only in Minnesota, but throughout the Midwest, probably to the country, and throughout the country that are applying to the University of Minnesota right now. So because that's happening, they can be a little bit more selective in their admission process. So our kids are getting in there, but the reason why I wanted just to take a few moments to talk about the U of Twin Cities, you know, the general conception is maybe it might be a little bit easier because it's such a large institution. The reality is not necessarily around that. But our kids, again, that are variable, but are around a 24 in the top quarter, are getting in. The UW schools, I'll highlight a couple of the very selective private schools. We have a fair amount of students right now at St. Thomas and Augustana. Augustana's in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. St. Thomas is obviously up in the cities, usually around a 23 and around the top 40% are kind of some benchmarks to hit. So here's another takeaway. A nice thing again about meeting tonight, we all have the spring semester of your junior year. And then you have obviously two semesters of your senior year. So for the students, if your GPA is, you know, right in this area, we'll hit ACT here in a moment, keep up the good work. If your grades maybe aren't, and your class rank maybe aren't where you'd like to see them, but you have ambitions to maybe to get into some of those schools, the nice thing is that you still have some time. You've got three semesters, and at least for sure, this spring semester, to maybe work on those grades and buckle down academically. The other common question is, do we have students, Scott, that maybe don't hit these benchmarks and get in? Yes, we do. But it varies a little bit from year to year. Most of the time, these numbers are pretty rock solid. If our kids meet those, they're going to get in. Okay, they're going to get in. The general college requirements, we have them covered here at Fairmont High School. What your sons and daughters are doing right now in their academic coursework are going to meet the general requirements for a four-year college or university. We require 4 years of English here at FHS, honors, advanced placement, college, and the schools. Even though students may get a lower grade, perceived lower grade in a more difficult class, colleges like to see rigor. They like to see students take difficult classes, challenging classes, even if their GPA is not that high. Here comes the next bad joke. I hear underwater basket weaving is an easy class. We've never taught it here at Fairmont High School, but apparently underwater basket weaving is pretty easy. Colleges would much rather see students take rigorous courses like advanced placement, college and schools, honors courses, and get a grade of C as in CAD or higher than get an A-plus in underwater basket weaving. So, you know, there is maybe such a thing as a senior slide, but I would say for our kids that are going on to a four-year school, you know, our top kids are taking 4 years of English, and a lot of times that senior year, they're taking AP Honors English 12 for free college credit, CIS with Mrs. Johnson, and then maybe we'll be taking speech CIS with Mr. Walker as well. So it's very much beneficial. 3.5 years of social studies, we're there. Minimum of 3 years of math. If you're thinking anything in engineering or medical related, we'll definitely encourage you through the guidance office to take 4 years of mathematics here in college preparation. Three and a half years of science. Mr. Seeger, thanks for showing up tonight. If you have any specific questions with the science requirement, you might have something to add. You have anything to add? The chemistry, physics, and your AP courses are offering taught.
We have a new anatomy and physiology class. Okay. College and the schools also.
So what would you maybe recommend for students that are thinking nursing, medical career, technology?
I've got asked that too, and I say, all right, if you're going medical, you're going to end up taking chemistry, physics, take physics. You'll get anatomy then too. Or take them both, take anatomy and physics. I have kids that are both chemistry and anatomy at the same time, and I have kids that are both in physics and anatomy. So they're your high-level student, and they're doing well.
Doing well. and they're getting into colleges and multiple institutions. So we have
one more thing though. Don't expect that anatomy credit's going to be your anatomy credit. I mean, that's for any credit that you take in high school, college. Like, you're going to go to a college, and the college is going to say, great, we love you, we're glad you're here, but we want you to be whatever, University of Minnesota graduate, so we'll take some of these credits on board, but some of them we're going to say you're going to need from us, too. And so we'll code it different, or, I mean, parents that have been through it, you've transferred schools or something, and you're like, well, what about this one? They're like, well, that's good, but you still need this one, so...
So the takeaway on top of that is, if you take A&P from Mr. Singer and go pre-med, and you just go to, we'll just pull the University of Minnesota Morris or biology major, for example, your advisor at Morris are going to say, we want you to take AP from us. However, what we're finding, and the credit is actually transferring, is the college credit that kids are taking now during their high school years, and I'll speak very slowly because it will fit, is counting towards their four-year bachelor's degree. It is counting. Depending on the school, it will fall under an area called liberal arts, general studies, or an elective. So I want to be very clear that the CIS courses that your children are taking and will take next year from professors or from teachers like Mr. Sigar that have a master's degree in their content area, and it's been blessed by Minnesota West, those credits are transferring in, but it probably, depending on the institution, I'll get myself a little small out there, depending on the institution, it will probably count in an elective or general studies area, but it will count and save you hundreds, if not thousands of dollars towards that four-year degree. Now, a few parents, you know, maybe just open that door for a minute, that have kids in college and did the CIS, would it be for our next group coming through, was that credit able to transfer in? Okay, I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but if you look around the room, you're seeing some heads nod.
Mine all did pretty good.
Okay.
I went to Morehead. So it's pretty easy to get
it. Sure. Absolutely. Absolutely. School? You can say school where it transferred into?
Bethel University.
At Bethel. And that's a private school. So by state statute, private schools and out-of-state schools do not have to accept the CIS credit, but it's transferred in. I knew that, but it's good for parents here. Two words.
Yeah, we have two at St. Cloud State. They both have credits transferred in.
Okay. Yeah. So on occasion, a question will come through is, you know, I took A&P or I took chemistry, they're still making me taken in college, am I getting that credit? The answer, for the most part, nearly 100%, is yes. I had a student go out to California probably about 4 or 5 years ago, and out there it didn't transfer. It just may not count in the major area, okay? But it is transferring in. Lastly, I'll kind of keep us moving here. Under foreign language, many of you probably know by now, a foreign language is not required for a Fairmont High School diploma. It is not. What most guidance counselors do, and what we definitely do here at Fairmont High School, is that we strongly recommend kids to have 2 years of a foreign language in college preparation. The question, obviously, is why? Again, it'll depend on the institution, but the first question is, Mr. Dean, my son or daughter didn't take 2 years of Spanish at the high school. Are they still able to get accepted into a four-year school? The answer to that is yes, as long as we're meeting some of the requirement guidelines. Now, the difference between high school and college, in high school, you can take 2 years of Spanish from Senora Stewart or Mr. Franta pretty much free of charge. The college advisor, whoever the Mr. Geerdes or Mrs. Schwieger might be at the post-secondary institution, might meet with you and say something like, we're accepting you to this school, our school, but I see that you don't have 2 years of a foreign language completed during your high school career. We would like you to take Spanish or Latin or Greek while you're here towards your diploma. Now, the biggest difference between getting 2 years done minimum in high school and college is that dirty word called tuition. It will cost you money, okay? So if your son or daughter has 2 years of a foreign language, generally speaking, I'm gonna paint a fairly broad brush for a moment. Typically, our kids, unless they choose, will meet that foreign language requirement at that school. If your son or daughter does not have 2 years of a foreign language, as long as the academics and the ACT score are in line, you can still go to college. But don't be surprised if the Mr. Geerdes or the advisor at the college may ask you to take a language class or two. So to boil it all back down, that's the very reason why we encourage 2 years of a foreign language during your high school career. And it's been pretty, for the most part, it's been pretty solid guidance over the years. There are other quick factors in the admission process. Leadership. If you've been a captain of an athletic team, or of a fine arts, or of the Knowledge Bowl, or math league, maybe you've done a solo performance or ensemble in band, choir, or orchestra, or had a lead or a major role in a musical. All of those things look wonderful on a college transcript. Activities both in school and out of school, fine arts, academics, athletics, part-time jobs, work through the church. Even if you've done those activities outside of school in the community once or for a very short time, they all help for the college to see the work that you've done. So, you know, in the next year and a half, definitely will encourage to stay involved in school and out of the community. I'm going to touch very briefly on the appeals process. Have you had any appeals yet, Mrs. Sweeger, this year? Have you had any seniors?
I have not had an appeal this year yet.
On a few occasions, we'll have a seniors, and I'll just speak generally, apply to an institution, and basically the college or university will decide to keep them in academic purgatory, and I'll explain that. They say, we're not going to accept you, but we're not going to deny you at the same time, okay? And most of those cases, they're going to want to see how your grades are happening during your senior year. We have had good luck, specifically with the school, just a little bit for your school, to the north of us, at times where a student may come to a faculty member or to us in the guidance office and ask to write a letter of recommendation on their behalf. So colleges do look very closely at grades, not only through their senior year, but if they're undecided if they're going to accept you right away, where your grades are at, where your grades are at the first semester of your senior year. So again, grades and academics are going to be very important all the way through your secondary years. Our Cardinal Volunteer Day, we take a day off, a day in our Cardinal Connections group, go out into the community. Boy, that's volunteerism. Make sure as we start to get in the application process next fall, and we'll be back around for that once school gets going with your kids. Volunteering, even if it's one time or a few times, put those things definitely on college applications. They do have meaning. Special talents, one quick story. And family, it's okay that I share this. I didn't think much of it at the time. But a couple years ago, we had a young lady that came through and she played the harp and wrote it on her, wrote her special talent, played the harp. I'm trying to get the story straight here, I'll slow down. And she sent her application off, and it was probably not more than a week later, she came into my office and said, Mr. Geerdes, got a call back from the college right away, and they want me to come and perform with my harp, and they're throwing some serious scholarship money at me. What do you think I should do? And I'm like, you better go. I said, first of all, talk to your mom and dad, you know, to see what their work schedule is, and then get down here, and I'm not saying that just because Mrs. Kay's here, it is a true story, get down to Mrs. Berkland and talk, and Mrs. Weiss, by the way, get down here to the fine arts area and see what pieces that you should play. You should absolutely go. And she loaded up the harp, went and performed what pieces, I have no idea, but came back and received a very significant and substantial scholarship to a couple of institutions by learning and really getting pretty good at playing the harp. So a lot of times with special talents, you think obviously of athletic scholarships or students that have a 4.0 GPA and a 35 or 36 ACT score. But that's not always the case. So if you have a hidden talent out there that you're good at, do not, the takeaway is don't be afraid to throw that on a scholar or on a college application, because you just never know how that could actually help pay for school. The last piece is kind of on the other continuum. You know, a lot of times parents will come to me and students will say, you know, Mr. Geerdes, my ninth and 10th grade year, I was more into the social aspect of school. I didn't study a whole lot. My grades weren't that good. Is there a chance that I can still go on to school, to a college, a four-year or two-year? The answer to that is yes, without a doubt. Without a doubt. Colleges know that sometimes high school careers academically don't always start off on a very high note. But if grades continually improve during your sophomore to your junior into your senior year, things should be very much okay for you in that regard. So if you're feeling like GPA class rank isn't exactly where it needs to be, colleges do look at improving. Okay? Very quickly, Wednesday, April 19th, right here at Fairmont High School, we are giving the ACT exam to all juniors. Here's kind of the ACT piece. We're going to give the writing exam as well. So it's the ACT plus writing. On that day, and on that day only, it will be free to all students and families. So the school district is on that day, is choosing to pay for our students to take the ACT exam. The question comes up, does it count as an official ACT score? The answer to that is yes, as long as you don't misbehave and get thrown out of the exam or get caught cheating. I'm going to tell you how to cheat, and then I'm going to tell you not to do it and how not to do it, okay? Many of you know that Fairmont we test five times a year. We're actually a regional ACT center. How students are excused from ACT testing, are the most common way this year is that they're filling in bubbles after the exam is completed. I'll give you a quick example. Let's say on test one, the test is over, time is called, you put your pencil down, the test supervisor sees that you've completed 35 questions on test one. You move on to test two, the room supervisor walks around the room, and yes, they actually aren't just walking, they're looking at your test and how many questions you've answered, and notice now that 40 questions are filled out on test one, okay? There's no penalty on the ACT for guessing. So at that point in time, we ask students to leave the testing center because we want to create a fair and testing, and fair and quiet and competitive testing environment as possible, okay? So on that day, believe it or not, you'll have a free ACT exam as long as you show up, you don't get thrown out, and you don't cheat, okay? I'm very quickly gonna give you some ACT basics, and then you can kind of decide as a class and as a family about how you're gonna attack the ACT exam. This might be a little bit difficult to see on the overhead, maybe not, but on the left-hand column are actually the ACT testing dates. If you wanted to test in California on April 8th and you're out there, you can actually do it. So here's some basics. These national testing dates are on Saturdays. They're always on a Saturday. If you would choose to test with us here at Fairmont High School, we test in September, October, December, April, and June. This next column will come into play here in terms of a strategy. The next national testing date is April 8th. The deadline is coming up on March 3rd, and we'll hit kind of some more basics here in a moment. So then the question is, well, Mr. Geerdes, do I take the test now on the national testing date on April 8th, or do I take and do the free one on April 19th and then decide? The answer is it's really up to you. It truly is up to you. I've seen it done both ways. For the upcoming fall, these are for those of you that work on the weekends and have busy schedules, which is many or most of our families, these are actually the testing dates for the 17 and 18 school year. You'll notice they haven't put a deadline in yet. But I'm going to send this all out to you in a link in an email here in the next few days. The reason why I didn't do that beforehand is I wanted people to show up first, so, and then we'll send the PowerPoint out. But I've got links for each and every one of you with those upcoming test dates. So here's an actual savings for you very quickly. The ACT without writing is $42.50. Okay? The ACT plus writing is $58.50. So the school district, for what it, for whatever this is worth, on April 19th is saving you $60. And yes, it counts as an official exam. Kind of behind that is, well, Mr. G, how many times should we take the ACT? And if you look above there, I'm not going to hit that link here just in terms of time. Many colleges require or recommend that students have a writing score. So how we handled it, and this has been rock solid for our students, is when we give the ACT for the school and we pay for it, we just throw the writing exam in, okay? So there's actually a savings in that regard. But there'll be a link there as you're looking at four-year or two-year colleges. You can search by state and then see whatever institution you may be looking at, what they're saying about the writing score. The big takeaway is we got you covered, okay? We've got you covered. So how many times can you take the ACT? We have kids, after coming to junior parent night, they take the ACT in the spring, they score 21 or higher, they're around the B average, they're in the top half of their class, they decide they're good to go. Now, I would not recommend this personally or professionally, but the record, to my knowledge, of a student has taken the ACT 5 times, okay? So if you want to take the ACT 5 or more times, you can actually do it. In very common sense terms, ACT will always take your money, okay? They'll always take your money. Now, here's the practical piece. Here's the common question. Mr. G, I take the ACT the first time and I score a 24. You now know 21 is kind of a magic number. I score a 24. I take it the second time, because I think I can do a little bit bigger, and I score a 22. Is that going to actually hurt me when the college sees my ACT score in terms of getting into that college or for admissions? The answer to that is absolutely no. Absolutely not. Every college or university that our kids have applied to, since we've been guidance counselors here, will always take your highest ACT score, whether you've got it on the first time, the second time, or heaven forbid, or God bless you, you take it 5 times, okay? So you are not penalized if you would happen to score lower the second time. Now, another common question, how many times do Fairmont High School students usually take the ACT? I would say, generally speaking, most of our students choose to take it at least 2 times. And I'll kind of maybe tie in a social piece and a confidence piece. Anytime you do something for the first time, you go into a social situation or someplace you're not really accustomed to, you might be a little bit nervous, a little bit jittery, maybe a little bit tense, maybe you don't give your best or maximum effort. But again, this is anecdotal. Generally speaking, our kids, when they come in and take it a second time, they know what to expect. They know how much time, they know how many questions, they know what's going to be on the exam. They know that it's going to probably take between 4 and 4.5 hours. They've done it once before. Typically, students will score higher the second time. Now, with all of that said, families in 2018, how many times you take the ACT is completely up to you. You can make that choice. We'll give you one on the house, so to speak, and that'll be April 19th. Okay?
Are they registering in school then? Because I've been on the registration
side. Yes. When we do the test registration for April 19th, we'll get you all together at some point in time in the future, and we'll take care of that in class.
Because then they have to upload a picture and everything for our school too?
No. The answer to that has been no. Okay. In the past.
So I've been on the other end and watched the pictures come in.
Yeah.
I was wondering, and I've been at school, but I wondered the new policy. Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Absolutely. Again, a deadline, and another kind of real quickly, a common piece. Typically, when students take the ACT the second time, they choose not to take the writing exam, okay? So once you have a writing score on the board, I can go on a little bit longer, but I won't. I still haven't figured out how colleges are using the writing score in their application and enrollment process. But typically when our kids take the ACT a second time, they'll take the non-writing portion for what that might be worth. And again, you can make that decision. The non-writing portion on the Saturday testing dates take is usually from about 8 to 12, 8 to 12:15. So it's around 4 hours of testing. The writing exam is starting to creep around 40 to 45 minutes of additional time. So we'll start right at 8 o'clock. Students are usually leaving the testing center around 12:35, 12:45, okay? So that's the quick spiel on ACT testing and some strategy. Any other questions or comments from the crew? I'll keep you moving, I promise. Okay. Very quickly here, we're going to touch on financial aid, some of the ways to pay for college. It's going to be the red handout. On page two are really the five basic steps of financial aid. I'm going to introduce the term FAFSA for you tonight. It's the free application for federal student aid. Our veteran parents already know this, but every year that you send your child to a two-year or four-year school, starting their senior year of high school, the state government, the federal government takes a look at families' income and assets, and then they determine how much money, good, bad, or indifferent. Again, good, bad, or indifferent. Uncle Sam says a family or your family needs to pay for schooling. So just very quickly on page two, if you want to use a rabbit ear, turn the corner down or make a mark, it might be helpful for you. Those are the five steps of financial aid. We'll talk about our financial aid night here in a slide or two. On page four, and again, I'm absolutely not posing as a financial advisor or investor, but on the bottom of page four, I've gotten feedback from families that there are some advantages for sending your son or daughter to college through some tax credits. So I would call your attention to some of those tax benefits, at least as they're on the books right now, as your child gets ready to go off to school, and then talk to whoever that person is in your family to see if you can qualify and can maybe use those things as kids are going off to school. And then last but not least, if you flip back to page six, and again, I'll just maybe mention this in passing, but I do think there's some value in reading through that. There are many grants, scholarships, work study here that are available to students and families, and some criteria for those pieces to help pay for college, and it kind of moves from 6, 7, and 8. So really some very basic key terms just to throw out for you tonight. When you see the word grant means they're typically based on income. They're given both by the state of Minnesota and the federal government. The federal government title for it, at least right now, is a Pell Grant. But anytime when you see your financial aid or award package, each semester your son or daughter is in school, and you see the word grant in very simple terms, take the money and run. Why? Anytime you see the word grant, there is no repayment method for that dollar amount for the student or their family. Now, there's obviously no such thing as free money. I'm saying grant is free for students from the point of view, if you qualify for state and federal grant dollars, that is money that does not have to be repaid once you graduate from that institution, okay? So grants are a good thing. Very quickly, work study. They're very much like part-time jobs. Families handle this a little bit differently. Mr. G, back in the day when dinosaurs roamed the earth, had a work study job for 4 years. For 2 years I worked in the library and kind of liked it and wanted to do something different. And the next 2 years I looked around campus and saw what other people were doing for work study jobs and worked in the gymnasium and wiped down equipment, worked out, handed out balls and got paid for it. Now, the takeaway with the work study piece is families handle that differently. Meaning, some families, when your son or daughter has a work study job, you'll get a check from the college just like you would at working at Hy-Vee or any part-time job. Sometimes families use that money or want their son or daughter to use that money to actually pay back towards the tuition for that semester. So families in certain situations have their students use their work-study money, their work-study job, to help pay for college. In other circumstances, it's just like a part-time job. You get a check every 2 weeks or once a month, and you put it in your pocket, you put it in your checking account, and you use it for whatever it might be. It will be up to you if you qualify for work-study, if you take it or not. Okay? You can decline work-study. So when you see that come through, it is a mechanism for students and families to work on campus, get paid, and then how you use that money is up to you. Loans obviously are repaid over time, so anytime you see the word loan after your financial aid package, when you see it, once you graduate, typically 6 months, 9 months, maybe up to a year, but it's almost like a car or a mortgage payment that Uncle Sam is going to start to expect you to pay that money back. So that needs to be repaid, and the interest rate is pretty low right now. Scholarships, academics, special talents, the heart, athletics, fine arts, all of those things. If you can get any money or qualify for any scholarship dollars in any one of those areas, take it. That would be the easiest way I can say it. So grants, work study, loans, scholarships are kind of the first financial aid pieces with this. Those of you that have older siblings may have known of our financial aid night. We are not an expert in financial aid, but we're smart enough to bring somebody in that is, okay? So the date is set, October 30th, next fall at 6:30 at the Commons. Jane Dins, who's the financial aid director at South Central College in Mankato, she's come to us now for well over two decades, will speak to us about filling out the free application for federal student aid and walk families through the financial aid process. For years and years and years, when we went to college back in the day, up until this year, students would graduate in the spring. You go from you look at the tax year from the year before. So in previous years, the class of 2017, the government would look at your income taxes from 2016, and they'd make an award letter based on your income and assets from the previous year. This year's class, our seniors in 2017, and again, who knows, I'm not going to turn this political, but how this will move forward or if it changes in the future. The federal government has called, and here's the new buzzword, to a prior year reporting for FAFSA. So for example, our seniors right now will be going to school this fall of 2017. Up until this school year, the federal government has looked at the income and assets of families from the previous year, from 2016. Prior year means, that's just their buzz term, they're now going to look back 2 years. So our students that are graduating right now in 2017, for the first time ever that I'm aware of, Uncle Sam is looking back to the 2015 tax year for families. Now I've learned this in this last year, a continuous learner myself. The question then is for the Jane Ginses is why did they do that? Why did the government decide to make that shift? Well, all the income taxes should be done. All the extensions, if you get one, are filed. Basically, everyone's income taxes should be fully done and completed from 2 years ago. So the idea, good, bad, or indifferent, is that it creates a level playing field for all families. So, I don't wish a bad year on anyone, but for you as families, we're now in obviously the 2016 tax year. As you are sending your students off to college in another year, Uncle Sam, the state, and the federal government are going to be looking to this tax year in determining how your income and assets are going to be affected in terms of how much you're going to pay from school or how much you don't have to. Okay, so for what that's worth, then take that information in your circumstances, in your family situation, for what it's worth. But I do think it's pretty good information to know going into your senior year of college. Very quickly, cost of attendance. Quick bar graph. This is very simplified. We'll say Gustavus is number one, $50,000 a year. School number two is MSU Mankato, around $20,000 a year. School number three is Louisville, Minnesota West tonight, at around $12,000 a year. Obviously a huge change in tuition at each one of those schools. When you complete your FAFSA form, do your taxes, get back what's called an estimated family contribution. How much money the government says, good, bad, or indifferent, how much you're going to need to pay or contribute towards your college education. The takeaway here is the EFC does not change. If that number is zero, it's a zero at all three of those schools, whether it's Harvard, Yale, Stanford, Gustavus. It's a zero if you send your students to Minnesota West. The EFC does not change. So as you start to look at schools and tuition costs, your expected family contribution, whether you go to Harvard or Yale, or you stay close to home at Minnesota West and go to a less expensive school, that EFC will not change. Very quickly, next fall, usually around week three or week four, depending on how many new students we get in at the start of the school year. We'll typically appear in the senior social studies classes, and we'll talk about college application.